William Morrow and Harper Audio present The Book of Dragons, an anthology, edited by Jonathan Strahan, performed by Matthew Waterson, Lorna Bennett, Eleanor Caudill, Feodor Chin, Mimi Chang, and M.W. Cartozian Wilson. My armor is like tenfold shields. My teeth are swords. My claws, spears. The shock of my tail, a thunderbolt. My wings, a hurricane. And my breath, death. J.R.R. Tolkien, The Hobbit, or There and Back Again. Introduction. When my two daughters were very young, I used to tell them bedtime stories. I'd make the stories up each night, but never managed to write them down, much to my youngest daughter's frustration. They were stories about a girl named Jasmine, who lived not far from their grandmother's house and who kept her dreams in a snow globe on her bedroom dresser, safe from a witch who sought to steal them, and of her best friend, a small orange dragon named Marmaduke, who was wise and brave, and helped Jasmine to understand how she could save herself. Marmaduke even engaged in some glassblowing, not too long after a family vacation during which we watched a glassblower at work. The memories are hazy, but I think the glassblowing had something to do with the unmaking of the world, which seemed a lot for such a tiny dragon, but magic can make heroes of us all. My own first memory of dragons, if it's possible to isolate such memories, given how pervasive dragons are in our culture, is probably Pete in the not particularly excellent Disney film, Pete's Dragon, in which a young boy finds an invisible friend, Elliott, who helps him when he needs it most and brings adventure into his life. If I can't quite be sure about the first dragon I encountered, it's hard to forget the many that followed, the greatest worm of them all, Tolkien's Smaug, raining fire down on Lake Town in The Hobbit, followed by Yvod, and the archipelagos of Ursula K. Le Guin's A Wizard of Earthsea, the white dragon, Ruth, from Anne McCaffrey's Pern, Naomi Novik's Temeraire, and George R. R. Martin's Dragons of Westeros, Rhaegal, Viserion, and Drogon. What do all of these great and mighty dragons have in common? Perhaps that they reflect some aspect of ourselves back to us through story. They can be wise friends and counselors, devious enemies and fiery opponents, and pretty much everything in between. Malin Long, in R.A. McAvoy's Tea with the Black Dragon, is a wealthy older man who simply wants to help a mother find her daughter. But it seems he is also a 2,000-year-old dragon. Lucius Shepard's great and maligned Greal from The Dragon Greal, possibly the greatest dragon to enter fantasy literature in the past 30 years, is a slumbering beast the size of a mountain range on which towns and villages are built, and whose human population both depends upon and hates him in equal measure. Dragons, it seems, have always been with us in story, and although I am not a researcher of folktales or an ethnologist, I could be convinced that dragons can be traced back to the first fires around which our distant ancestors gathered, inspired by dark places beyond the light of the fire and the reptiles that lived there. I'm much more skeptical that they are some sort of species memory of dinosaurs, but let's not rule that out. Regardless, the way we see dragons depends on where we are in the world. In the West, the image of the fire-breathing, four-legged, winged beast arose in the High Middle Ages, perhaps a variation on Satan. The Western dragon is often evil, greedy, and clever, and usually hoarding some terrible treasure. There are the dragons of the East, long, snake-like creatures seen as symbols of good fortune and associated with water. Serpentine dragons, like the Naga, are found in India and in many Hindu cultures, and are similar to the Indonesian Naga or Nogo dragons. Japanese dragons like Ryujin, the dragon god of the sea, are also water creatures, and so on around the world. Lizard or serpent-like features are a constant, but the dragon itself may or may not take human form. can be a creature of any of the four elements, air, earth, fire, or water, may crave wealth or not, and may or may not be able to take flight. But it will live at the heart of its story, as the dragons do in the stories in the book you now hold. The Book of Dragons grew out of my desire to spend some time with a new group of dragons and the people who encounter them, and so I turned to some of the best writers of science fiction and fantasy of our time and asked them to tell you the story of their dragon, the one that filled their dreams. And they responded with a bestiary of dragons as rich and varied as you could wish for. In these pages, you will encounter dragons on distant worlds as they follow us out to the stars, in the rain-drenched mountains of the Malay Peninsula, in the barn, and living just next door. They are alternately funny and fearsome, fiery and water-drenched, but they are all remarkable. The stories and poems in the pages here, from Daniel Abraham, Kelly Barnhill, Peter S. Beagle, Brooke Bollander, Beth Cato, Zen Cho, C.S.E. Cooney, Elliott de Bodard, Kate Elliott, Amal El-Mohtar, Sarah Gailey, Theodora Goss, Ellen Klages, R.F. Kuang, Anne Leckie and Rachel Swirsky, Ken Liu, Scott Lynch, Todd McCaffrey, Seanan McGuire, Patricia A. McKillip, Garth Nix, K.J. Parker, Kelly Robson, Michael Swanwick, Joe Walton, L. Catherine White, Jane Yolen, and J.Y. Yang are all I could have wished for, and I hope you will love them just as much as I do. Jonathan Strahan, Perth, Australia, 2019.
What Heroism Tells Us, Jane Yolen. There is the smell of the heroic in the air, a pair of hawks circling their nest at feeding time, rabbits escaping the talons and claws of destiny, the flesh of impala laughing in the hyena's mouth, flash of sword repeating in the dragon's eye, the princess rappelling down the tower on a rope of her own hair. Even more, I think it's the sight of you, my friend, pulling love out of despair, snatching happiness from the ash of winter, pushing open the closed door, letting in spring. Matriculation. L. Catherine White. L. Catherine White, lcatherinewhite.com, was born and raised in Buffalo, New York, where she learned valuable life skills, like how to clear a snowy driveway in under 20 minutes, a lot easier than you think, and how to cheer for the perennial underdog, a lot harder than you think. She is the author of the Hearthstone series, Hearthstone, Dragon Shadow, and Flamebringer. When she's not writing, she spends her time reading, drinking tea, and having strong feelings about fictional characters. She should have been ticketed. The cop stationed on the roof stared at her as she flew past, heedless of the portable speed scryer screaming in her hand, her mouth open in a perfect O. Mealy caught the briefest glimpse, only heard the radar's beep as a smudge of sound whipped past by the wind, but she blessed whoever had assigned a rookie to this route. Clearly the cop had never seen a dragon before. By the time she had recovered, Mealy was already out of sight. Landing in Pawn Row was always tricky, and Mealy sensed, rather than saw, the undead eyes peering at her from under stoops and out of upstairs windows, curious to see whether they would be contacting their insurance companies before day's end. She shifted her weight, and the dragon banked. The steel and alchromium bones supporting its wings caught the red rays of the evening sun, and the light licked along the dragon's chassis with the faintest crackle of magic. She felt it like static, raising the hairs on the back of her neck. "Down, buddy," she whispered, and signed the symbol for descend on the thormium plate by her right hand. The dragon folded its wings and dived. The stone spires of the university and surrounding shops melted into a salty greyish blur as the wind tugged tears from her eyes and gravity lost meaning, and for one perfect instant she was free and all was right with the world. Then the world remembered itself and gravity caught up and it was all she could do to sign the landing sequence before the dragon joyously sent them both crashing onto the roof tiles below. Its wings snapped out, billowing like swollen kites, and Mealy heard the scrape of metal on stone. Her finger left glowing lines on the thormium as she traced out the symbol for perch, and with the hiss of steam and cooling steel, the dragon settled on the edge of a roof overlooking Pawn Row. She unhooked her harness and swung out of the driver's cockpit.
"You know, there are fines for scratching the facade," a voice from the cornice said.
Mealy yelped. She managed one stuttering step toward the roof's edge before catching herself on the dragon's outstretched wingtip as an image of tomorrow's headline flashed through her mind's eye in all its ironic glory. "Young Magitechnician scholarship winner perishes in tragic accident 2 days before term starts."
"Careful now," the gargoyle said dryly. "Forget the fine. You don't want to take a tumble."
"Yeah, I'm not that lucky," she mused, glancing over the tiled parapet. It was only 2 stories to the cobbles of Pawn Row below. A fall from that height might merely result in a mess of broken bones and bloody gashes, especially if she hit the roof of the stoop first. Not that that would improve her situation. Spilling blood on Pawn Row was as good as a death sentence anyway.
"You could try a sign," she muttered.
The gargoyle crouched on the corner of the building, tilted its head, and peered at her with one obsidian eye.
"You could try not parking on the roof, love."
"And miss the view?"
"Nah,
he likes it." She pulled off her flying goggles and patted the dragon's chassis. "Don't ya?" The gargoyle gave a pointed look at the guano-streaked crenellations of the row of shops opposite them. Beyond, just visible through the smog of wood smoke and industrial alchemicals, the spires of the University of Uncommon Arts and Sciences rose to dizzying heights above the city to which it had given birth. He sniffed.
"Ah, well, can't fault him for that."
She smiled slightly. She didn't make a habit of smiling. But then, who was the gargoyle going to tell? If she had to guess, he was up here for the same reason she was. It would take a dedicated vandal to paint obscenities on anything parked on the roof, dragon or gargoyle.
"You're not going for, dinner, are you?"
the gargoyle asked as she stuffed her goggles into the satchel at her side.
"No," she said firmly. "Just a bit of shopping."
There was a grinding sound as the gargoyle turned to face her. Expressions on gargoyle kind rarely branched out into anything that couldn't be described as stony. But even so, she could see he was surprised.
"Starting at the university on Monday?"
he asked. It would have been so easy to lie. Just a nod, and the conversation could be over. But then again, why should she lie? It wasn't as if she wouldn't be attending the university. The two were on the same grounds.
"Institute," she said.
"Technical branch. Keep an eye on him for me, will you?" The gargoyle's eyes twinkled.
"Good on you, love. The world could always use more magitechs. Sure, I'll watch your ride. Just don't be long. And please, if at all possible, be human when you get back. It's awful disorienting when they're not."
"Don't worry, I will be."
"I assume you know who you're dealing with down there."
"Carl's an old friend," she said.
The gargoyle gave a gravelly chuckle.
Well, if you say so. You take care of yourself, all right. We'll both be here when you get back."
She thanked him again and turned to the dragon. It sat motionless on its haunches, surveying the street below with what she liked to imagine was a protective gaze.
"I'll be right back, buddy," she whispered,
and whistled the locking sequence her father had taught her. A few notes, carefully arranged, changed every month or so, and nonsensical to the casual listener. To a keener ear, or to anyone who'd been close to Mealy for longer than 6 months, the random sequences might begin to form a pattern, just discernible as the beginning of a song. A more patient listener would find the entire tune laid out within a year, and they might wonder why such a pretty lullaby had earned this practical vivisection. Fortunately, no one ever managed to stick around for more than a few months. Mealy made sure of it. The golden light faded from the dragon's eyes as it settled into standby. "Back in a bit," she told the gargoyle, and headed for the rusty fire escape on the side of the building. The bell chimed softly as she opened the door.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.